So you're probably wondering, what are these lovely plants doing here and what happened to them? Well, they're dying. That's what happened to them. You can say that these wonderful little darlings here, they grow on a lot of farms around here, and people would love them. And I put a little chemical on these a couple of weeks ago because I'd been thinking about this message to help them die. It's called gramoxone. It'll kill about anything, and it's doing a pretty good job, isn't it? But this thing is so resilient. It just, man. And then here, of course, Johnson grass. My dad always talked about Johnson grass. Said, son, we ever found out a good use for Johnson grass, it'll quit growing in your field. And I thought, well, that's true. And I went out to California one time, and I was going out through there, and I kept seeing all this big 15 feet tall stuff. And I said, what is this? What is this? It's all Johnson grass. I mean, like we grow cotton and rice, but they grew Johnson grass. I said, what in the world? We give that to you for free. Why do you want to grow it? I mean, they took care of it like a crop. And I said, what in the world would you be growing Johnson grass for? And they say that out there in certain parts of the, in California, that the land has no consistency. And so the Johnson grass has a root system, and they would take, that's what they would blow on the side of the roads, and it would grow fast and take a good root system, and it would keep the dirt and soil from eroding. And I thought, that's a great place for Johnson grass on the side of the road. So we do have this little darling this morning, and you're thinking, okay, well, what's that? And we got this water hose. Anybody ever seen a water hose? Yeah. Got a sprayer on the end of it. Obviously, we're not using that on these plants. But I want to talk to us this morning for a little bit. I believe it's already interesting because, you know, I could leave here and you'd be wanting to come back tonight to hear the rest of this message because you're thinking, what in the world is going on? So why don't we just do that? Why don't we go ahead and leave? And we'll come back tonight. So you're saying, yes, we're going to beat people to lunch. We're not going to beat people to lunch today. It's 11:13. It's not my fault. I want to talk to us for a few minutes, about living among the dead. Now, a lot of you are into different movies. Who was that came in and said that was my favorite show? Was that you? Talking about Walking Dead. I've never seen the show, seen advertising. The Walking Dead. I don't know what it's about, so I can't really comment too much. But living among the dead. So you see my little illustrative. Obviously, it's going to be an illustrative message. But does anybody know the real purpose of a water hose? You ever thought about a water hose? We don't think about a water hose really till you need a water hose. You know, I don't lay in bed and think, I wonder how they made a water hose. I wonder where my water hose is. I wonder if my water hose is too hot outside. I wonder, did I cut the water? Does it still have water in it? I don't really think about a water hose that much. But you know, there's a few times in life I've really thought about a water hose. When something catches on fire, you want to, where is the water hose? And you go get it, and you have went over to Fred's, and I'm not beating you up. You went to Fred's to buy a water hose, but come see me. I'll give you $50 for a good water hose. And you go and you stretch out that water hose from Fred, and that thing just wads up. Yeah. And you're stretching on it, and the more you stretch, the stretcher it gets. And there's still no water, and you're just, oh, my goodness. But this water hose here, you know, it's hard to tangle this water hose up. It's a good water hose. It's a good water hose right here. It's hard to tangle that up. And so you get to look in the water hose, and they're not that important for the most part. But you know what the purpose of a water hose is? Now, this is just some of the stuff I wrote down. The purpose of this water hose is to get, we would say water. I got a little comment in a minute. But to get water from one point to another point. That's the purpose of a water hose. I guess I've seen a few people, you know, tie it around a couple of bumpers and use it as a tow rope. It'll work there if you stretch it enough. And when I was growing up, I thought about Ralph when I was preparing this message and especially this next statement. It'll do more than carry water from point A to point B. You know, you can cut your section off. When I was growing up, you put it in the gas tank. Can't you, Ralph? Not snorting gas, you're stealing gas. It's different. Arkansas credit card, that's right. And I remember, you know, growing up, Dad, I'd say, Dad, we're out of gas, and we'll go get some out of the truck. And I'm thinking, you know, now kids go out and get a can. Oh, no. You get out the rubber hose behind the back seat, It was cut speed. Get daddy's siphon hose and you'd get a whooping. So there's water hoses used for a lot of purposes, but we're not going to talk about stealing gas and siphon gas and snorting gas today. We're going to talk about the purpose of this water hose is to move water from one point to another point efficiently as possible. And it does that. It's created for one thing. That's really what it's created for. To move water from one point to another point as efficiently as possible. It uses this process called containment. This water hose is actually hooked up to the hydrant out back. And I can take that water hose and I can cut that water hose on, and by containment, water staying inside this, I can force water through this water hose and I can take water all the way out to the backside of this property. We do it to water trees. I could also take this same hydrant and I could do it differently. I could build little levees and run water all the way out there to that water. It'd take a long time and it'd be very costly and ineffective. But this water hose has a purpose. It's to get water from that hydrant to wherever I want to go efficiently as possible. That's what this water does. But it uses containment. And you need to get what I'm telling you because it's going to play into my message in a minute. It forces this water into a confined space in order to reach a determined destination. So let's compare the church to the water hose and maybe some of these dead plants. Is the church the water inside the water hose? Or is the church the water hose? Don't answer out loud. What would you think as the church? Should we be the water hose? Should we be living water? Now I guess you're thinking, you were thinking we're all going to stay on the water hose and it's all about the water hose. Well, actually the message is not about the water hose. But you'll remember this message because you've seen a water hose. So now it has two purposes. To help you remember this message. No, that was good. That would have been an amen moment. So is the church the water inside the hose or the hose that brings the water to a specific point? Arguments can be made for both that the church could be the water hose and that the church is the water, the thing that has substance that brings life inside the water hose. You know, you can take this water hose and we could leave this right here and these plants could be vibrant when I put them in here. And that water, this hose could be full of water. And this water hose could lay here for years. And these plants can lay here for years right next to, matter of fact, this one's actually touching the plant. It can lay here and water be within an eighth of an inch from it. And those plants will eventually die. You can be so close to the very thing that'll give you life, but if things aren't just right, guess what? You can be that close and still die. So is the church the water hose? Or is the church the water in the hose? I'm going to propose to you this morning, we're both. We should be specific and focused like the water hose as the church. We should be specific and focused on getting the gospel to the world, the water hose. But arrive at the destination with the living water, the substance inside the hose. It doesn't matter how fresh the water is. If the water is not flowing from the water hose, things still die. I began to look up a couple of weeks ago, pictures of deserts and oases and rivers that are in the desert. And that's some of the prettiest pictures you've ever seen. Where life is just so vibrant in trees and grass and stuff all along the banks of these rivers, and go 100 feet outside the bank of a river or a reservoir, an oasis, and it's just nothing. You think, golly, there's a place somewhere, I forget the place, one of those little countries, and they have built this town around a 20-acre oasis. And the primary source of income around this oasis is tourism because it is so beautiful. You look at this 20-acre lake, and it probably consumes about 35 acres when you count the buildings around it. And you look at them, you think, that is just a normal town. I mean, they have hotels, and you can swim in this oasis, and there's abundance of water. But it's like 200 miles in the middle of nowhere. And you got to know you're going there, you know. And you get there, and it's just like a beautiful resort. And it's like, wow, that is awesome. What brings so many people to that place? Water. Water. Take out the water and everything else is dead. What's supposed to bring people to the church house? Living water. Why are they not showing up? Don't answer yet. Why is the world looking for every answer in every other place other than the church house? Because I think the church believes they're only the water hose. As long as we've got it and we contain it, we're okay. God forbid that we get outside the water hose. God forbid we spring a leak, revival break out. God forbid that, you know, the sinner, the drunkard, the prostitute, the addict come to church and get touched, my Lord. That's our water. Lord created that for us. That's living water. That's not for you. I've got scripture. Just bear with me. So let's talk a minute about the water in the hose. Why does the water not flow through this hose? Well, there's two reasons why the water is not flowing through this hose. One, it's off out back. I was going to have it on, but there's a leak in this dead gum thing. You know why? Because I bought that thing right there down Fred's. Doesn't seal correctly. So there's two reasons. One, there's no water in it. And two, this little thing here called a sprayer or valve. You know, and I push this, watch, there'll be water everywhere. I wish that thing would have been pressurized and just shoom right through here. There's this thing inside here. It's a little valve. It's got a little plunger. And, you know, I can cut the water on and you know, this doesn't leak, but it leaks right in here. And that water still won't flow through there. There's got to be something applied to the end of this hose that allow the water to flow through. And I wonder sometimes, is the church, are we the stopper? Are we the valve that allows the world to get the living water that's on the inside? I know this is a very basic, simple message, but I'm simple. And we need simple messages because theologically deep messages obviously has not helping the church. Because look where we are. I'm all about that. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I'm not a theologian, but, you know, there we go. So here it is. So what does the Bible say about flowing and operating and being obedient to the Holy Spirit and letting the Holy Spirit flow through us? What does the Bible say about that? And I'm going to bring out a couple of arguments in just a minute. John chapter 7, verse 37 says this. That on the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried. Now, we're not talking about a prophet. We're not talking about the disciples. We're talking about Jesus. He at the feast, he stood and he cried this, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. It's hard for me to believe. Of course, that's you can use that in a couple of ways. You could be talking about the last day, and it's also talking about a particular feast where Jesus is saying, if you're thirsty, come and drink. The church should be standing aloud today as Christ's ambassador and saying, come and drink. Come and drink of the living water. Jesus did it. Where's the church? You know why I believe that we're not? We're not sure we have living water. We're not sure that God can do everything He says He can do. Hang on, I got a text. Here's my argument, number one. The church is the water hose, the container, the containment. The church has become the containment. Watch this. People don't even know if they need to drink from the Lord anymore. Most people that you run into, they don't know that they're supposed to be asking the Lord to drink for a drink. We're into the second generation of people who have been raised by parents who didn't go to church. We're in that second generation. They don't know that there's anything different because the world is laid up beside them and the world is still dying, and we call ourselves the church, the water hose, and we're rubbing shoulders with the world. We're in jobs. We have positions. We're allowing ourselves to be elevated in jobs, in politics, in the world, and we're rubbing shoulders with the world, yet the world's dying and we're doing nothing about it because we're keeping what we believe to be living water contained. We don't want to offend you. We don't want to make you mad. I don't want to lose my job because of my faith. Well, you know, can I tell you something that's coming? Let me tell you what I heard this week. Now, this is a shocker. This was a shocker to me, and I don't get shocked by too much. The state of Iowa, couple states north. I know that you think, well, that's up there, but no, they're in the United States. Iowa. Do you know the state government of Iowa sent out just this week mandates to the church that says you will comply with transgender restrooms and you will comply with transgender sensitive teachings in your church? I didn't say in another country. I said in Iowa. You look it up. Three states north. Of course, that's going to be repealed and stuff, but who would have thought that you go look this up for yourself. Who would have thought that would ever been in question? The church. You know why? The church has said, well, what I've got, I'm going to contain it. You know what the world picked up on? You keep doing that. Now you'll have to contain it. No, matter of fact, I don't want you. I'm going to filtrate my system, my belief system, into your church. Therefore, you can't even contain what you really believe. You'll have to accept what I want you to accept. I'm not preaching you a message to scare you. I'm wanting you to get this message so that you will understand that we can no longer be the containing apparatus of the Holy Spirit. That we can no longer say, I've got it, and you know what? I'm going to keep it right here within the four walls. You could look at the church building as being the water hose. Boy, we're all in here, and we're all lively, and we, you know, Pastor Brandon, he comes up, and he helps us to worship and engages, and our worship team do such a great job of praying and seeking the Lord, and they lead us into His presence, and man, it's wonderful presence in this room. We can say, boy, the living water's here. And we go right out the door. We leave it here. We leave the presence of God, the living water here. And the people that we do not talk to about the Lord, they're the ones making decisions. I was praying earlier this morning when I got here. And over here in this area. And I said, Lord, what do we do? Where are we at, God? What's going on? How do we combat this? I had a lot of questions for God. And then this one thing rose up in my spirit. I remember one word, and it's kids. I thought, well, God, that wasn't the answer to any of my questions. And then this came into my spirit. Who was the Sunday school teacher of Donald Trump? The Sunday school teacher of Hillary Clinton, of Paul Ryan, Mike Pence. Who are those Sunday school teachers? What church did they go to? Who was the pastor of the person who leads the LGBTQ L-M-N-O-P-Q-R-S-T movement. Who was that pastor? I'm real with you. You know that probably Donald Trump, a Hillary Clinton, just because of their age, attended church because that's what you did. When you, they're older. I mean, come on. They probably attended as many church services as you did by the time they were 20. What happened? What went wrong? So here it is. If you teach in this church, step your game up. My God, we don't know that who's going to be the next person that we'll send out of here that's going to be in those political positions. Well, that ain't ever going to happen to us. You know what? You're absolutely right. You need to step down teaching. What if I thought each one of you didn't amount to anything? Well, I ain't going to amount to anything. I'm not going to prepare. I don't care. I don't care if they go to hell or not. But what would you think of me as a pastor if I didn't care? Come on, this is good stuff. We've got to start saying, you know what? I am the living water. I'm not going to contain it because I'm holier than thou, and I'm not going to prepare myself so I can pour myself out to kids on Wednesday. Well, they're just kids, you know. They're just snotty-nosed brats. Yeah, you were too. So was I. Move on now. Anybody know that Billy teaches kids? Argument number two, that the church is the water. So we have an argument that the church could be the water hose or the church could be the water, the living water. It'll go either way. We could be deemed positive or negative in either direction. But in John 7:38, the Word of God says this, "He who believes in me, as the Scripture has said," not because someone else said, because as the Scripture said, "out of his belly will flow rivers of living water." Now, if you look up the word belly and you do a study on that, that word means koalia, and this is what the definition is. The innermost part of a man, the soul, the heart, as the seat of thought, feeling, or choice. So I have a question. Is the heart of the church people? It's not a trick question. It is. The building cannot feel. This building does not have a choice what it'll be. This building does not have a thought. It's a building. Look at the building as the water hose. But the church, the heart, the thing that makes this church live and vibrant, and the reason we have worship and the reason we have teaching and pastors and all that stuff, is because there's human beings, there's people that have life in them. We can leave here today and we can take the sign out the front and put Civic Center. We could put Ralph's Garage on the front. Whatever you want to put on there. And you know what? The building won't care. The building won't care. I've been in sports arenas where I know that there's heathenistic, sinful stuff going on, and you can go in there and they can you can have a youth function in that thing, and man, you feel the presence of God. Why? Because the building's the building. The building has, it can't affect you that away. Amen. So the church, the people, you and I, we are the living water. Every born-again believer is the water in the water hose. We should be. I think too many times we as church-going people, we got saved and we thought, man, we're there. We're done. We're finished. Thank God. That's just the beginning. Somebody failed to teach you that you're living water. You're to flow, not to get and stop. You're to be a blessing. You're to reach people's lives. You're to go. You're to be effective in the world. You're to be a world changer. You're to be a history maker. But somehow we thought, well, we've got our job done, man. We got saved. No, it's your privilege. It's not a job. It's a privilege. So who are the people? of this church. If we're the heart, people of the heart, who are they? Who's the heart of this church? This is, you can answer this. Who is the heart of this church? We've established that it's people, but who is the heart of this church? Raise your hand. Say, me, me. It's me, Pastor. Let's do it. It's me, oh Lord, standing in need of prayer. Y'all remember that song? Maybe we should learn that song, worship team. Maybe we need to get that to us to understand it's me needing prayer. Y'all didn't know I could sing that well, did you? Billy, you're to be living water. Containment is where you're at now. You contain. So what does the Bible say about the heart? I'm talking about you, by the way. If you hadn't pieced it together yet, you are the people, the church. And I'm going to be talking about your heart, the heart of the church, for the next few minutes. The heart of the church. Say, I am the heart of the church. I want everybody, because I think some of you say, well, if I don't say it, it doesn't apply to me. Let's say it out loud. I am the heart of the church. Let's be personal. I am the heart of my church. That's good. See, I got everybody involved in. So when you leave, this applies to you. So what does the Bible say about the heart? In Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, it says this. For where your, what is it up there? Your treasure is. Brandon, you hit all over. Man, I seen little heap to preach my message. There your what will be? Let's do a little refresher course because we're going to have a test in a minute. Who's the heart of the church? And according to Scripture, your heart's got a treasure. And wherever you place your treasure, you're going to be. So if you look at the church, what is the church's treasure? What is the heart of the church? And where is it? Well, I can help you. What are you passionate about? What are you after? What do you want to see happen in your church? If you don't want to see anything happen, guess what? I can help you find your heart. It's not here. It's everywhere but here. Come on, this is good stuff. I know it's simple, it's elementary, but dear God, I'm elementary. So where's your treasure? Where's the treasure of LVA? Because if I find the treasure of LVA, I can find her heart. Boy, I could go a bunch of directions here, and man, woo-wee. Ralph wouldn't talk to me for a week. As a matter of fact, he'd wait till next month. Matthew 12:34 says this. I'm reading from the King James Version on this one. It says, O generations of vipers, or evil people, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You know, I've been in a lot of churches in my ministry tenure. And I can tell you by looking at these scriptures where some of their hearts are. Because if there's a bunch of gossip and dissension in the church, it's where the heart of the church is. I didn't make that up. Because out of the abundance of the heart, what? The mouth speaks. So if in the church there's nothing but gossip and dissension and divisiveness and it's brooding in the church, guess what? That's where the treasure of the church is, because out of that treasure we speak. Woo-wee. I wish I had my big, long, tall socks on, baby, because these is falling down because, you know, I got some come up about right here. Some of you know my 3-4-tier tan line. It's a different message. These done slid down, Brandon. Preaching to myself. So where's the heart of the church? What are we passionate about? Is the church passionate about prayer? Crank the car. Is Is this good stuff? I'm just telling you, I'm not telling you right or wrong. I'm just pointing out where your heart is, because I know where your treasure is. What does it say? Where your treasure is, not where your heart is. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be. What's precious to you? My kids are precious to me. You see them, you see part of my heart. Come on. You see my wife, you see part of my heart. Because she's precious to me. See my mom and my dad, they're precious to me. You see this church, when you look in the mirror, you say, my God, I may not be precious to anybody else, but my pastor loves me. I'm passionate about you. You're my heart. That's why I preach these messages. If we wanted a good message, I'd get Pastor Brandon to preach for you, get you all worked up, pumped up. Because he's good, man. He's good. He got good content. I'm not saying that's the only way he preaches. I'm just saying he's good. He's a better orator than I am. I know that. But I got a pastor's heart. I want to see you grow and develop. Amen. So here we go. It says, O generation of vipers, I'm reading it, Matthew 12, 34. How can you be evil? Being evil, speak good things. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You know, it's often said that if you talk to someone for 5 minutes, you can figure out what they really are like, what their passions are, what they're about, what their motives are in 5 minutes. And, you know, that's pretty much true. You can tell someone's really a thinker, or someone just says, okay, well, whatever. You know, you can tell if they're, man, I got to go. You can tell what's on their mind in about 5 minutes. So when the world runs into us, the heart of this church, the living water, are we the water hose and keeping everything contained on the inside when they speak to us? Are we speaking really from the abundance of our heart? Because whatever you speak is really what you're after. Whatever's coming out. If you're all time... Oh, Lord Jesus, help me, God. Somebody pray for me. Say, Lord, help our pastor. No, I'm serious. Say, Lord, help our pastor. Woo! I feel the Holy Ghost right now. I'm telling you, I do. I'm not messing with you right now. I'm serious. Woo! Holy Spirit's here, I'm telling you. Ooh, I'm a abundance of the heart. I don't think you're getting this like this is resonating in my spirit. It's beginning to rise right now in my spirit. Boy, it's ministering to me. The abundance of your heart. What do you talk about all the time? There's your treasure. Can you go 2-3 days and never mention God to any of your coworkers? Well, I'm here to tell you that I'm just going to just put it out here like I perceive it, like it is. Then he's not your treasure. Woo! Come on. This is just good stuff. So who did we say the heart of the church is? We are. You and I. We're the heart of the church. If we're the heart of the church, then what are we speaking to the world? I tell you what does this community say about us? Don't say everything the community says about us. Because their treasure's in another place. I mean, do you hear things like, I heard this yesterday. So I said, man, you always got to go, something going on at your church. What are y'all doing there? Loving people, preaching the truth, worshiping the Lord. I don't know. I mean, that sounds like a pretty good plan to me. The cool church. You told you the cool church. The cool church. I guess that'll work, the cool church. I'm okay with the cool church. I hope people see that we're the anointed church, that we're the in love with Jesus church. That we're the power church, that we're the church of the living water, that when you come, man, you can get something. Even if you wasn't looking for it, you can get something. I like for people to be surprised when they come to our church. Sometimes they surprise me by what they say they were surprised about, but I'm okay with that. It's like, wow, man, I didn't see that one coming. I like for people, you know why? Because if they're surprised when they come, Well, they'll come back probably, but maybe. Sometimes they don't. But if they're surprised, they're like, I didn't see that coming in church. That's not what I had church pictured as. There's the problem. That's when the church has become the containment. Oh, I thought church was supposed to be ABC cookie cutter. I don't think so. There's only supposed to be one church, by the way. Woo! One church. The Church of Jesus Christ. Not of Latter-day Saints either. The Church of Jesus Christ. If you come from that, I'm okay. I sometimes should just stop. Right? Hallelujah. 1 Chronicles 16:23 says this. And this is what we should be speaking to the world. Now, this is scripture. You can say all you want to. That's not my personality. I'm going to disprove any of that theory this morning. I wasn't made that way. Wrong. The Lord, I'm beginning to show you something. The Lord, He didn't make mistakes. How many of you know that? If He makes you and says for you to do something in the Word, He gives you the ability, the talents, and all the personalities and all of that stuff. The other stuff is your containment of letting the living water flow from you. Here it is. 1 Chronicles 16:23 says this. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. What's this? Proclaim. Shout aloud. Let it get out. I went to church yesterday. What was that? Extol, I think was your word to what was that definition? To praise excitingly or something like that? Even? Proclaim, to get it out there so they can understand. I have to tell people sometimes, speak up, I cannot hear you. Maybe you may be really loud, it just may be my hearing, but either way, I can't hear you. Speak up so I can hear. Speak louder. Proclaim the good news of what? What does it say? His salvation. Don't you think that if we're about lost souls, if we're really about the person, if we're really concerned about somebody going to hell, don't you think that out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth's going to speak? If that's our treasure, don't you think that we would be, hey, there's a problem if you sin. Man, that's good stuff. The Bible says that you would proclaim. He didn't say, now, if you got the right personality, I want you to proclaim. I know you've been raised different, I tell you what. If you just, I'm going to, tell you what, here's my card. It's not my card, but here's my card. And you get a pass. You don't have to. You don't have to proclaim the goodness of His salvation. You know, I know you're church, I know you're the deacon, and I know you're the pastor, but you don't have to. Do you understand that there's no exceptions? Watch this. Oh, that's just one verse. Psalms 49 says this, I have proclaimed the good news of righteousness in the great assembly. Indeed, I do not restrain my lips, O Lord. You yourself know. Can we say that, as David said? Can we say, Lord, you know I didn't restrain my lips. Man, when I walked into the room, I began to talk about you, Lord. I proclaimed your righteousness. Do we talk about righteousness? Or do we send nasty jokes to our friends over our text messaging? Ooh-wee. Well, nobody saw that, so it's okay. You see, if we send it that way and we don't really say it, then I really didn't say it. I shared it. I didn't say it. I shared. Therefore, I didn't originate. Oh, I didn't read all of it. You might want to read all of it. I've had to come back on my stuff, and some people share some. I've shared some things, and somebody called me, hey, Pastor, do you know so-and-so is in that? That word? Oh, no, I didn't. I've deleted stuff. I try to pay attention. My daughter watches me all the time because she knows I'm kind of illiterate and pulling stuff and passing it on. You know, Dad, you know, you need to let me see that first. Probably so. That's why I don't do the church Facebook page. You know, sometimes you just know your weaknesses and your strengths. Psalm 96 and 2 is the same passage of Scripture as 1 Chronicles 16, 23. Isn't that cool? God repeats himself because he wants you to get it. When you repeat something to your children, why? Because you want them to get the message. Don't do that. It's wrong. Psalms 96, 2. Sing to the Lord, bless his name, proclaim the good news of his salvation. How often should we do that? Man, he leaves nothing out. Not once a week. Not once a month. Not on Sunday. It's so easy for me to talk to you about the Lord here on Sunday. My God, you're Christians. It's not nearly as easy to talk about the Lord when somebody pulls you in your parking lot and turns around. Is it Ralph? But you can. See, what most people don't know about that whole situation, and you'll hear the story later if you hadn't heard it. What most people don't know about that is I was angry and I sinned not. You should know that. I'm your pastor. Did I, Ralph? I have a witness. I did not sin. I was close. I rode the fence. I was there. But I did not sin because God's with me. And what you don't know about that story is after a couple of hours of whatever, negotiating, I had two men in my office, and I began to talk to the one man, and I noticed his hand was a little withered, two fingers. And I said, dude, what happened to your hand? He said, developed diabetes when I was 18 years old. Arthritis when I was 18 years old. And I've been on arthritis medicine, and he's 64. Been on arthritis medicine for all these years and still hadn't helped me. I said, well, it doesn't look like that's working for you. He said, no, and that medicine caused me to have cirrhosis of the liver. And he said, I've never drank in my life. And I thought, oh, man. So they got ready. I said, can I pray for you? He said, I take all the prayer I can get. I said, Father, I hate that we've met under these circumstances. I'm not crazy. See, we didn't meet the way I thought I would be meeting someone if I was going to pray for them. I said, Father, I hate that I've met this man under these circumstances. But Father, this cirrhosis of the liver is not of you. And I command it to leave his body in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray blessings upon this man. Lord, I pray you bless his finances, bless his health. Lord, I command it to never come back on him. The actual truck driver, Ralph, because that was the owner, was standing also in my office. And he's looking and he says, just pray for me too. See, here's the deal. This is what I learned out of that. I don't have to bow down and let you run over me as a Christian, nor will I. I can stand my ground. I can never cross that boundary, though, of sinning where that I'm not effective to you. And the church, I believe, has become the water hose and said, I'll just contain it all right here and I don't want to offend you and I'm not going to step out of my boundaries and I'll let you run over me and do whatever you want to me. I don't think so. That's the problem with the church. It's time for us to stand up in holy boldness, be strong in our faith, be firmly planted in this word to know, no, absolutely not, you cannot do that to me. Absolutely, I love you, and I can find that boundary between allowing you to run over me and me laying my hands on you and saying, God, heal him, and I mean it with all of my heart. It's a big difference, church. It's a big difference. Psalms 96, 3 says this. I want to read 2 and 3 together. I've already read 2. It says, sing unto the Lord, bless his name, proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. That tells us how much. Verse 3, declare his glory among the nations. That tells us to whom? His wonders among all peoples. Again, that tells us to whom? We're to proclaim His goodness. We're supposed to give living water. It's time for us to quit being the water hose. And saying, as long as everything stays in the church, as long as everything stays with my family, as long as it stays within the confines of the people who think like I do, I'll let it flow. Otherwise, you can't come in my club. Is this making any sense? See, we got clubs. You know, preacher, they don't believe like we do. You know what they're doing, don't you, preacher? You know, I need to talk to you about them. Now, I know you know, I saw you hugging on them the other day. Let me, come here. There's some things I know that you don't know. Probably so. And newsflash, I don't care. Because the moment I get concerned about all that stuff, you know what? The Lord... I'm just speak a little holy boldness. I'm not boastful. Y'all know me. But you know, the Lord has this strange thing of letting me know what I need to know about somebody. It's called discernment. It's called one of the gifts. Happen to know that. Happen to operate in that. Am I going to let things by sometimes? Sure. You know why? It wasn't because God wasn't speaking to me. Sometimes I just wasn't listening to God. But for the most part, I promise you, the Lord will let you know what's going on. But see, we want to take those people and say, you know, they probably, you want to really watch them. I'm all about wisdom. Because nobody's ever come to this church for the first month and they got put in a leadership position. Newsflash, it's not going to happen either. Well, thank you, Pastor, for watching out for us. Well, you're just quite welcome. Yes, you are. Thank you very much. Some of you don't know the challenge that is. I've had, anyway, glory to God. Matthew 12:35 says this, and I'm going to be closing a minute or two. Honey, why don't you come on the piano? Because that's good. They like that. Matthew 12:35 out of King James says, and a good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. Out of what? What does it say? Out of the good treasure of your what? Your heart. See, it combines those two things again. What's your heart? What would be, as a Christian, one of the greatest things that Christian people could give a sinner? The Word, plan of salvation, Jesus Christ. That ought to be our treasure in our heart. To want to give the world this living water. Quit containing it. What if they come to church one more time? They've been 6 months. They come one more time. And I tell you what, if they come one more time, the preacher barks like a dog underneath the piano, and that's going to be my sign, I'm going to go to them. Come on. Your sign is, I got saved, I love Jesus, He's my treasure, I should go tell the world about Jesus. That's your sign. Quit praying for a sign. I've asked the Lord for signs. I've put out fleeces before and all that. Those are good things. Some things you don't need a sign for. You just do because He said to. So what is the answer to all this stuff? You say, well, Pastor, that's great. I know you talked about the water hose. Are we the water? Are we not with water? Are we the water hose? Or not? It don't matter. Are we the dead plants? Is this world and we're living among it and they're still dying? You know, my coworkers are dying. Mm-hmm. Some of our family members are dying. Some of our family members are dying and going to hell. You know, if I had you put on a piece of paper three names of some family members that you have their phone number in your phone and you call frequently, if they died today, they'd go to hell. You have those people in your family. I have them. You can't make anyone get saved. But I can tell you this. If my son or my daughter or any of you, if I see you falling away or straying, guess what? I'm going to be on the phone with you. Some of you can say, yeah, you sure will. It's not because I'm trying to beat you up. I'm not in your business of what you're doing here on earth. I'm in your eternal business because that's my job. I don't do it to be nosy. I know a lot of stuff that doesn't mean nothing, doesn't mean anything. I want you to be the best you can be. I want you to know, hey, somebody's looking out for me. So we ought to be as a church. So what's the answer to this whole thing, Pastor? What do? It's summed up. This is really simple. The church needs revival. Did you hear me? The church, let's back up and review because the test is being handed out. Who's the church? Everybody say, I am the church. I need revival. This building doesn't need revival, church. The heart of the church needs revival. If your treasure is not about lost souls, if your treasure is not about the healing of those that are broken, physically, emotionally, spiritually, whatever, if your heart, your treasure's not there, your heart is not there. That's why we must have revival in the church. We're still worried about everything else. Why the carpet colors this way, and why do we not do this, and why do we do that, and why do we build the church this way, and who done this, and oh my God. Is this real? This stuff won't matter. There's things that we don't argue in this church. I'm just saying the church as a whole does this. I've seen it. We argue so much about junk. Let's just get past it. And where is the lost sinner? I'm going to read you some stuff, and I'm going to close, but I'm not in any hurry. And if you feel like you must leave, I love you. You can just leave, okay? I'll see you next week. I'll call you. I love you. You're not going to offend me. Here's some things that let us know that the world is dead. But these same things that lets us know the world is dead can also mirror that the church is dead. Jonathan Edwards says this, that there will be a time of degenerate time with dullness of religion. He made that statement in 1742, before the Great Awakening happened. There was a degenerate time. There was a dullness of religion. The world's dead. The church has a dullness of religion about it. We just come and go through the motions because we can feel good. It's what we're supposed to do. It eased my conscience. We can tell our coworkers, and we call it witnessing that we went to church. And somebody asked, did you witness? Oh, yeah, I told them I went to church. That's not a witness. That's telling them where you were. Here's another statement about revival. Revivals usually occur after a prolonged spiritual and moral decline. Can I get a witness that that's where we are in the world? We've been on a steady moral and spiritual decline since it took Bibles out of school. Prolonged. We're there. By definition, revival requires a state of death. You know, if everything was in love with God, we wouldn't need revival. If the world was in love with God, we wouldn't be worried about transgender. We wouldn't be worried about Bibles in school. We wouldn't be worried about LGBTQ and all that stuff. We wouldn't be worried about people sleeping with people and running around and doing all this before they get married. We wouldn't be worried about that because they would not be dead. Wow. By definition, a revival requires a state of death, neglect, or loss. How many of you can witness that we have had a neglect of the gospel of Jesus Christ poured into our children? I mean, come on, I said it earlier. This is the second generation that's raised by parents who did not go to church. There's a great neglect. My God. This has always been true historically. You can look this up by history, that these things happen. The church becomes apathetic to its master, its morals, and its mission. Our greatest mission of the church today as a whole is, can I make you happy and how can I make you happy? Oh, we don't have that program, but if you come because you look the part, you play the part, you smell right, oh, you're going to tithe good. Well, I tell you what, we will create something that'll make you happy. Not happening. Because things won't make you happy. If you come, I don't know about other churches, I speak for ours because this is our church. If you come here and the Holy Spirit can't make you happy, I sure can't make you happy. I don't have a chance. I don't have a chance in Hades of making you happy. If the Holy Spirit can't do it, then it ain't going to happen for you. It loses its zeal and becomes ineffective. Its worship becomes dull and uneventful, and its membership declines. It needs to be revived occasionally. I'm talking about the church. We know the world is dead. We see them. We live in the church and we think the church is alive and vibrant because we got good worship, because the pastor preaches this or that, or because we feel good. And boy, the church is on fire. Show me the fire. Show me the healings. Show me the salvations. Show me the baptisms in the Holy Spirit. Show me these transformation qualities. Show them to me, and I'll say the church doesn't need to be revived. Woo-wee. Pastor, you really preaching down my socks today. Well, I'm glad. I'm preaching down mine too. It needs to be revived occasionally for its own sake, speaking of the church. These are things that go on right before revival breaks out. What I'm here to tell you this morning as your pastor, historically speaking, from 1740 to current, if these things are in alignment for revival to break out in the church of today is a prime candidate for revival to happen today. Amen. Give him praise. Can you do that? I'm talking about reviving of the church. We need revival to sweep our homes, to sweep our churches, and our communities, and then our nation. Can I tell you this? Until revival happens in the church house, you can forget praying for the nation, because if you're not right, guess what? It's not going to flow. I know some of that's in some of you believe, and you said, he said not to pray for them. I'm just telling you, you got to get right here. If revival's not here, how am I going to give revival to you? If I've got the living water contained, how is it going to get out? We skip over our children. We skip over praying for our babies. We skip over, say, well, it's not important. It's just Wednesday night. Just not that important. Well, let me tell you some importance that I saw on Wednesday night. I go up in the classroom up here after class, some 20, 30 minutes afterwards, and I see, are you ready? I see teachers and other adults of children in that class laid on the floor before the Lord, crying out to God, God, send revival in this church on Wednesday night. And we think it's an inconvenience. Thank you, thank you, thank you for saying, I'll get before the Lord when I want to go home, when I've worked all day. I want to see these kids changed. It's not a job. It's not something that they say, well, it's good. We got to have a position filled. My God, no, they're after souls. And we think it's just Wednesday night. They don't really need it. We're tired. They've got a lot of homework. Newsflash. They just didn't start giving homework to your kids. They've always had it. I had it. Miss Janice had it. Long time ago. But we use an excuse. I'm going to preach a minute. Can I preach just a... Can you give me a couple more minutes? I know it's 12, 11. I know some of you ancients, and my God. Woo! I got to preach a minute while I'm here. Revival's got to start at the house. One of the greatest, I think, tools of the enemy. Pastor Brandon, you ain't got to leave? No. He knows I'm this way. I've been waiting for 2 years to do that to him. No. No. That's good. One of the greatest tactics of the enemy to steal your children. Are you ready? The excuse. The excuse. Oh, there's many. You, Pastor, you just don't know how tired my kids are. Pastor, you don't know how much homework they have. You know, they get on the bus at 6. I hate that. I do. I rode the bus when I was a kid. I understand all that stuff. But you know something else I remember as a kid? I went to church on Wednesday night. I went to church on Sunday. You know something else I remember as a kid after doing homework? I know you don't think this, but I actually went to an academy. They actually have, they require quite a bit of stuff. But you know, before we went to bed, you know what Mama done? Mama said, is that right, baby? Mama didn't done that. Mama did. She's on me. I'm telling you, see, I was educated. I'm educated. You know what Mama did? Get in here, boys. Bible time. Made you read the Bible. Made you study the Bible. My mom would read a passage of Scripture, a whole chapter, Tyler, the whole chapter. My mom and dear in the daytime would make questions up and you had to answer them correctly. And if you didn't, she'd say wrong answer. I'm thinking, my God, are we in school? I'd rather go to school than let my mama teach me. My mama never could homeschool me. Oh, no. I'd be dead. My mom would say, she'd read that and you had to pay attention. That's why she made questions. She'd make these questions out. All right, it's your turn. Marty, it's your turn. What was the answer to how old was Methuselah? What was Methuselah's mother? His name. Maiden name. I don't know. Who cares, Mama? You had to go through this. Guess what? We were tired too. We were tired too. I'm telling you, if you're a parent in here, if you're a parent, I need your attention. I am a parent. I've raised my kids. Done okay. I didn't slack. But if you're a parent or you're going to be a parent, I'm telling you, you need to listen to this. If you got to make excuses for your kids, if you make excuses and blame them on your kids, because you can't get them to church, you can't study with them, you can't read them the Bible, you have a treasure issue. Did you hear what I said? You have a treasure issue. Because where your treasure is, your heart, that thing that gives you life, will be there as well. If you're a parent in this room, young children, and you tell your kids no, and they never check up, I'm going to preach a minute, and they never check up and they don't acknowledge you, you have a treasure problem. Woo! Preacher, you meddling. No, I'm preaching the gospel to you. If you don't discipline your children, I don't care your method. If you don't discipline your children now, you have a treasure problem. The Bible says, spare the rod, spoil the child. You have a treasure problem. Pastor, that's awful hard in this. Oh, I mean, yeah. I prayed for my kids all the way through. Oh, God, don't let them turn out crazy. Oh, God, don't let me eat crow. Some of you means, you know, what I said, they're going to do the opposite. That's what crow means. You know, I never worried about that. Because the Bible says, train up a child. That word child means five and under. If you'll get their attention when they're babies, and I'm speaking to parents, small children. If you'll get their attention when they're small, you'll have their attention when they're older. But you can't wait till they're 13. Woo! My, it's a shout. You can't wait till they're 15 and bring them into my office and say, Pastor, what happened to my child? Nothing happened to your child. Your child is perfectly okay. Well, what do you mean? You don't know what they've done. They're doing exactly what you've taught them to do. They have great comprehension. They push the boundaries as far as you'd let them. They are perfect. The problem is not in the child. Woo! I know this is unpopular in a setting in a society where we say, I'm not responsible. You are responsible. As a parent, God entrusted you with a child. You are responsible. Just as I am responsible for preaching you the truth as a father figure to children in a church setting, as a pastor and shepherd, as I am responsible to you and to him, you are responsible to your children. And if you're raising grandchildren, the same applies to you. You probably didn't ask to have this card dealt to you. But it's dealt to you. That does not mean that you're off the hook because you're grandparents. Oh my. Barrett, I may have to have you escort me out. You still love me, don't you? In a move of God, God's Spirit will use ordinary men and women. In a move of God, he'll use a Tyler, a David. So who's going to use Dewana? He'll use a Dewana and a Bubba. Well, I don't know about that, Pastor. He used me. Ordinary men and women. Quit looking for the great next revivalist to come along. The evangelist. It might be you. Matter of fact, it is you. It's you. He's going to use ordinary men and women to proclaim the gospel, to get his word out there. He's not looking for the Jensen Franklin to come in. Oh, he's using Jensen Gradley. He's wanting another one. There's unsaved people. My Lord. He uses ordinary men and women. Ordinary. To accomplish the unordinary things of God. Because God is not ordinary. God's unordinary. He's supernatural. And he'll use people. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care what your story is. God can use you. God can use you. George Whitefield, a revivalist years ago in the late 1800s, early 1800s, George Whitefield, his father and mother owned a tavern, a beer joint. And his father died. And his mother ran the beer joint. Imagine that. Lord, she can't come to church. Some 8 years later, got married. George Whitefield quit school. He was around all kind of stuff. Think about it. In the 1800s, it wasn't. I ain't gonna get on you, but it wasn't. It wasn't spectators. Somebody saying, "Oh, what's wrong with spectators?" I just go in there for the steak. There was prostitution, drug rings, drug lords, pimps, alcohol, adultery going all around him. And he grew up in it. He quit school at 17, says, I don't want to go back. Got saved at a church. Somebody had some living water flowing. Got saved. He was very intelligent. Went back to school, finished high school, and went on to Oxford. And became one of the great revivalists. Don't talk to God about your circumstance. He's not buying it. He's not buying it. So will you stand with me across this room?